Hello, statisticians. Mr. Young Saber here from Skew the Script. I've sometimes had students come up to me and say, I'm going to drop out of school and become a social media influencer. Today we're going to explore if you can make an actual livable wage from working on social media full time. We're going to do that by using one sample T interval for me. Let's skew it. Today's lesson is on the confidence interval for one me. This is lesson 8.1 in our course sequence. So it used to be that when students would threaten to drop out of school, they would say, I'm gonna become a musician, I'm gonna become an athlete, I'm gonna become an actor. And they aspire to have the crazy salaries that a lot of these entertainers make. But more recently, it's been, I'm gonna drop out and become a YouTube creator or Instagram influencer or a TikToker. I don't know if that's the right word, but I'm gonna say it, TikToker. Because some of those celebrities end up making a lot of money just from their work on social media. And then if you add on other work in advertisement deals, they make a lot more. But these salaries I'm displaying here are just from social media alone. So today's key analysis is, do social media creators, on average, make a livable wage? This is lesson 8.1. If you want to follow along using guided notes, you can print them up at this URL. So topics for today, we're first going to talk about the sampling distribution for a sample mean. And the data we're going to be discussing today was collected directly from YouTube. I searched up how much I make on YouTube, and you've probably seen these videos before. YouTubers will take you through their ad revenue on the site. And the nice thing is that it's reliable data because they're literally displaying for you their exact page's ad revenue. Very hard to make a fake page of that. And they show dynamically how much they've been making month to month. So I randomly sampled among my search 35 results. And today we're going to be looking at estimating the mean incomes from those videos. So there's two types of means we could talk about. There's mu, the population mean, and there's X bar, the sample mean. So mu is the population, and that would be the mean salary among all YouTubers. X bar is among the sample, that's the mean salary in the sample that I got to try and estimate the population's mean. So let's set up a sampling distribution. In a world where, let's assume the true mean salary among YouTubers is $55,000, and the true standard deviation of those salaries is $29,500. So we're gonna do, in a world where these assumptions are at play, we're centered at 55,000. But in most real life scenarios, you don't know the true mean. So you survey a random sample of 35 YouTubers, and among them say that the yearly average earnings was $60,000 among your sample. So you're gonna use that 60,000 as an estimate for the true mean, which we don't know, but it's actually 55,000, just assuming that. So if that were the case, we'd be overestimating the true mean by $5,000. So we can take this thought example and think about, when I estimate something that I don't truly know, how far off will I usually be? Let's take a trip on down to theory land, the not real place, but we're gonna pretend like we know the population mean and think about what kinds of samples we would get. So in a world where the true mean salary for all YouTubers is $55,000 with a standard deviation of 29,500, we're gonna get a random sample of 35 YouTubers from this world. And we get one sample mean. This one happened to be a little bit below $55,000 among the 35 we sampled. And then we could do this a bunch of times, is get a bunch of random samples of 35 YouTubers. And each time when we get a sample mean among our sample, we're gonna get some different estimates. We're gonna see that those estimates are gonna make a normal curve, approximately a normal curve. And under certain conditions, we can actually model this normal curve as follows. We're gonna be centered at the true mean. So most of our means are gonna be centered around that 55,000 true population number. And the typical distance from the true mean can be modeled by this formula. The standard deviation of those salaries, the raw standard deviation, divided by the square root of our sample size. This is the typical distance of our sample means from the true mean. And we can plug in what we know. So in this theoretical world, we know the exact true mean salary. We know the exact standard deviation. We can plug those numbers in. And when we do the math, we can see that we're centered at $55,000 with a standard deviation of our sampling distribution of 4,986. So we're gonna be centered at 55,000 with about 5,000 of deviation. So that means that when we get a sample, we're gonna be typically off by just shy of $5,000. So our typical estimates for the true mean are gonna be off by about 5,000 usually. So in this case, we overestimated the true mean by 5,000. Going back to our earlier example, we got a sample mean of $60,000. And now that we know the sampling distribution, we can see this is a pretty typical error. The actual error is $5,000, and the typical error measured by that standard deviation is 4,986. So this is pretty typical. So there should be a way when we're estimating something to report both our estimate, in this case, 60,000, and how far off this estimate might be using the sampling distribution. The way we do that is through a confidence interval. So let's talk about the exact interval we would make in this case for a sample mean. So I went ahead and I got the data from my random sample of 35 YouTube videos under the search, how much I make on YouTube. And this is the exact data that I found. So I created a dot plot of this data, and we can see there's a fair amount of spread, and we can get some statistics going here. So I plotted on here the individual poverty line. So in the United States, someone's considered in poverty if they make less than $12,760. And the mean wage in the US is $51,916 when I looked up this data. The mean in the sample was $70,106. And the mean among my YouTubers that I found was $70,000. This is impressive. They're making more than the US mean wage. It's a pretty impressive salary. But there's a lot of variation here. We see some YouTubers make a lot more, some YouTubers make less. So what if we just by chance happened to sample an unusually popular set of YouTubers and overestimated the true mean? How can we take that into account? Well, let's make a confidence interval to account for that possible error. So we're trying to figure out the true mean salary of all YouTubers. It's something we actually don't know. I don't have the true population mean. My best guess was the mean of my sample of 35 YouTubers, $70,106. So let's put some error bounds on this to account for random sampling error. So let's consider all the possible random samples in our sampling distribution that could have happened, but didn't. In this case, we know the sampling distribution can be modeled by this normal curve. We're gonna plug in our sample size, which is 35 YouTubers. We don't know the true mean, so we're just gonna plug in our sample mean as our best guess, so 70,106. And here's the thing, we don't know the true standard deviation of salaries among YouTubers. So how do we estimate the true standard deviation of all YouTuber salaries? Well, we found the sample standard deviation among our sample, and that's probably our best guess estimate. So let's plug in the sample standard deviation to our formula there. And so our best guess was 82,000 for the standard deviation among YouTuber salaries. And so we can use that in our formula to calculate the standard error of our mean estimates. And I know this is now called the standard error because we're using that sample standard deviation as an estimate here. So our standard error was about 13,800. So we have a distribution that looks something like this. And to capture a 95% confidence, like a normal interval, we're gonna go 1.96 standard errors out on each side. And we're gonna make the interval based on that to capture 95% confidence. But wait a second, we don't know the true standard deviation of our sample means. That's because we plugged in the sample standard deviation in for sigma rather than the true standard deviation. We're uncertain about this because we use the sample standard deviation instead of the population one, because we don't know the population one. So how do we account for this extra uncertainty? Well, the solution is to use something called the T distribution. Here's a normal curve, like we've always been looking at. This is a T curve with 1 degree of freedom. What does that mean? Well, the T distribution is wider than a normal curve. It's also symmetric. And we use it when we want to capture the greater uncertainty of using the sample standard deviation to estimate the true standard deviation in our standard errors. And the degrees of freedom that you see there is, in this case, going to be the sample size minus one. Degrees of freedom is something that you use to measure how precisely your sample standard deviation is estimating the true standard deviation. And as with most estimates, the higher your sample size, the more closely you're gonna estimate the true standard deviation, and you're gonna approach a normal curve. So this is degrees of freedom one, so just sample size two, it's very wide, as you can see. But as soon as you get to the higher sample sizes, so this degree of freedom five, which means we sampled six, we're getting closer to that normal curve, we're getting a little bit skinnier, and then once we get up to 20, and then eventually 30, we're getting very close to approximating the normal curve because we have precise enough estimates of our errors. So instead of finding a Z critical value like a normal curve, we're gonna find a T critical value for this T interval. That tells you how many standard errors you should be including in your interval. Now for a normal curve, when we use Z, the normal curve, it was 1.96 standard errors out, gave you 95% confidence. Because we're using a T distribution, we need to go a little bit farther out because we have more uncertainty to capture the 95% confidence. So we need to go wider. And so we need to find that T star in our case. So the way to do it on your calculator, show them right here. You can take a pause, try it out yourself. But essentially what you're doing is you're plugging in the degrees of freedom you have. You want the area under the curve before a 95% to be 0.025 is 2.5% on each tail. And then you get the T star. So just try that on your calculator if you want. And in this case, it's 2.03. As you can see, it's slightly higher than the 1.96 we needed for a normal curve because we need to capture a wider interval. So we have the confidence interval for mean, and it's always going to be the point estimate, in this case, the sample mean, plus or minus the critical value T star times the standard error from our sampling distribution. So let's plug in what we know. We have the sample mean, we had the standard error from before, and now we calculated the T star. We need to go 2.03 standard errors out. Plug those in, we get an interval with margins of error of about 28,000. So our interval is from 41,900 to about 98,300. So we are 95% confident the interval from 41,900 to 98,300 captures the true mean yearly income of YouTubers. The big range, but we're confident that's going to capture the true mean income of YouTubers. So let's go through the four-step process to show how you would do this on a real FRQ such that you would maximize your points. So remember, we're going to do the state plan do conclude method. This is just a way to organize your work such that you get full credit on those FRQs. When you're asked a question like this, and this is the same question we've been addressing this whole time, construct and interpret a 95% interval, we know that language means I have to do the four steps for inference. So first, state. You need to state the parameter you're estimating and the confidence level. I'm estimating the true mean yearly YouTube salary, mu, at 95% confidence. Name your inference method. Well, I'm doing a one sample T interval, because we have a T interval for means, for mu, if all conditions are met. We need to check these conditions. Why are we checking conditions? Well, recall from the sampling distribution lesson that in order to know that that sampling distribution that we base this whole interval off of is normal, is unbiased, has a calculable spread, we need to check these various conditions. Otherwise, our interval is going to be completely off. So random, the sample of 35 YouTubers was collected randomly. That's true. So we're going to have an unbiased interval. The sample size has to be less than or equal to 1/10 of the population size. This makes sure we have a calculable standard error. So 35, my sample size has to be less than 10% of all YouTubers. That's a pretty reasonable assumption. There's way more YouTubers than 350. And then the sample size has to be greater than or equal to 30 in order for it to, the sampling distribution should be approximately normal. So 35 is greater than or equal to 30. That's true. The sample size is large enough. Now let's perform our calculations. We have our statistics here. We had the sample mean, we had the sample standard deviation. You can plug it in by hand like we did before, or you can just simply use your calculator, take a pause, look at the calculator steps to do it if you want to try it at home. Otherwise, make sure when you're writing this up to show the calculator inputs that you had and then to report the final interval, which is the same interval we got before. It's going to differ slightly because of rounding when we did it by hand, but it's very similar. So let's interpret the result with context. We are 95% confident the interval from $41,877 to $98,300 captures the true mean yearly income of YouTubers. Wow, they're making a fair amount, aren't they? Well, let's discuss this. So actually, we can directly estimate the true mean income of YouTubers from ad revenue using direct estimates provided by YouTube. So in 2019, YouTube reported a total ad revenue for the whole site of about $15 billion. Billion dollars. And we know that creators get 55% of that revenue. So if you get 55% of 15 billion, that's about 8 billion and some change. So we can divide the amount that creators got in total by the number of creators, which was at the time 18 million. So divide that rounds out to about $463 per creator, just $463 per creator. So that's the average yearly pay for a creator as of 2019. And we know the individual poverty line was $12,760. So that's not a very good salary. But you might be thinking, how is it, like, our confidence interval is 41,000 to 98,000. How could this other estimate, which is using those direct numbers, get such a low yearly salary compared to what we got from our sample and our interval? So that's our question for today. Why was our confidence interval so far off compared to our direct estimate? That's it for today, statisticians. Have a good one.